much here as St Alphage that you welcome me as the visiting priest. And for the next hour, we will devote ourselves to listening to what God has to say to us and of coming together by receiving the sacrament of Christ's body and blood. So welcome to this church on this lovely autumnal morning. We meet in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires turned, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters, as we prepare to listen to the word of God and receive the sacrament of Christ's body and blood, let us first recall in sorrow our sins and failings, shortcomings and transgressions of the past week. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought and in word and in deed, and in what we have left undone. We are heart of sorrow and repent of all our sins. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Thank you. God of power and mercy, protect us from all harm, give us freedom of spirit and health in mind and body to do your work on earth. We ask this in our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, your Son, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the first book of the Kings. Elijah the prophet went off to Sidon, and when he reached the city gate, there was a widow gathering sticks. Addressing her, he said, "Please bring a little water in a vessel for me to drink." She was setting off to bring it when he called after her. "Please," he said, "bring me a scrap of bread in your hand." "As the Lord your God lives," she replied, "I have no baked bread, but only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am just gathering a stick or two to go and prepare this for myself and my son to eat, and then we shall die." But Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you have said. But first make a little scone of it for me and bring it to me. And then make some for yourself and for your son. For thus the Lord speaks, the God of Israel, jar of meal shall not be spent, jug of oil shall not be emptied, before the day when the Lord sends rain on the face of the earth." The woman went and did as Elijah told her, and they ate the food, she, himself, and her son. The jar of meal was not spent, nor the jug of oil emptied, just as the Lord had foretold through Elijah. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. but it was heaven itself, so that he could appear in the actual presence of God on our behalf. And he does not have to offer himself again and again, like the high priest going into the sanctuary year after year, with the blood that is not his own, or else he would have had to suffer over and over again since the world began. Instead of that, he has made his appearance once and for all, now at the end of the last age, to do away with sin by sacrificing himself, since men only die once, and after that comes judgment. So Christ too offers himself only once to take the faults of many on himself. And when he appears the second time, it will not be to deal with sin, but to reward with salvation those who are waiting for him. This is the word of the Lord.
Jesus sat down opposite the treasury and watched the people putting money into the treasury. And many of the rich put in a great deal. A poor widow came and put in two small coins, the equivalent of a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "I tell you solemnly, this poor widow has put more in than all who have contributed to the treasury, for they have all put in money they had over, but she, from the little she had, has put in everything she possessed, all she had to live on." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
That time of year, really quite extraordinary fortnight, which begins at Halloween and ends with the playing of Nimrod at the Cenotaph in Whitehall on Remembrance Sunday. And all this is accompanied by nature shedding its leaves, which first change from green to golden, yellow, or brown. It is not a beautiful time of year, but a haunting one, with the daylight hours diminishing. Some people really don't like this time of year. They get a little depressed, feel locked in. Whereas others, they like it. After all, we are all different. Nature dying before our very eyes is the yearly reminder of perhaps the year's shortest of seasons, autumn, which heralds the barrenness of winter and the inevitability, perhaps even the beauty, of death. It all starts with Halloween, an Irish festival, which came to our country not from Ireland, but from the United States. After all, would Imperial England accept anything from the first country to break away from the empire? I doubt it. The word Halloween is derived from the word, the phrase All Hallows Eve, which is commonly known now as All Saints Eve. The custom was essentially a light-hearted way for children to cope with the reality of death. Then, of course, next comes All Saints Day, a glorious sort of equivalent of Easter, in which we are all called to share in. It was Paul who reminded the awful church at Corinth that they, for all their faults and serious shortcomings, were called to be saints. And that, in fact, is our high calling today. We're called to be saints. However pious, religious, or wayward we are, and there were plenty of them in the church of Corinth, we must never forget our high calling to be the people of God. There is the hymn, the line of the hymn, "We feebly struggle, vain glory shine." The reality of the saints is, and if we look closely at their lives, they too struggled with the imperfection of their hearts, minds, bodies, feelings, and emotions. My friends, for all of us, there is hope. Then on the 2nd of November, there is All Souls Day, a relatively new commemoration which came after the Great War because of the carnage of that war, in which countless millions of young people died, and the grief felt throughout Europe, a double grief for so many widows, the tragedy of war, both for those who fought and those who stayed at home. You know, if humankind is to survive, it has in fact a lot of growing up to do. Which brings me to today's Gospel and Old Testament reading, both about widows. The first account is a moving one, which was about the hospitality that the widow and her son, who had nothing left to eat but a few scraps, they were preparing themselves for death. The holy man came along, Elijah, the greatest prophet of the Old Testament, and asked them not to be afraid, but give him some of their food. And as a result of her kindness, the food never ran out, nor did the oil for heating. There was always sufficient until the drought was over. And in this account of the widow and her son meeting Elijah, there is the echo of the feeding of the 5,000 in the Gospels, and also the words of our Lord when he said many times before and after his resurrection, "Do not be afraid. It was the climate that brought the drought, and as you know, it is climate change which is the biggest issue confronting us today. I realise that humankind has always lived on the edge of a precipice. Any reading of history brings this about. The words of the Litany, the Book of Common Prayer, say, from plague, pestilence and famine, from battle and murder, and from sudden death, good Lord, deliver us. And those words apply to us today, as they did in the 17th century. Do not be afraid. And there is truth in this. Since we do have the capacity to change the way we live. But of course, we have to put our minds to it. Not for this generation, but certainly for the next generation, your children and your children's children, and subsequent generations. You know, this business, the term the climate change has been around since, I think it's 1973. It's taken us 50 years to wake up to the fact that we have to do something about it, whether we like it or not. Now, in today's gospel, and Mark is a very brief gospel, a little snippet here and there. There's very little narrative apart from the passion, the end. And so we have this sort of a few verses of Christ's, what he saw happening at the temple. And in fact, the rich widow is the only person, that's very important, the poor widow is the only person in St. Mark to get the praises of Jesus, and that's a thought. Well, one's first reaction of reading this is, was the temple worth paying into? You know, into such an institution. But of course, the temple in those days carried out all the welfare and social work that the state provides today. And that was true of the synagogue then too. And I'm sure some of you will remember from the Acts of the Apostles, the early church was known for sharing out what they had with one another. Those who were destitute were given help. And so they were following in this Jewish tradition of helping each other. And of course, the early church was known for generosity to others. Generosity to all has always been at the heart of the Christian faith. We're called to be generous, as Christ was generous. He gave his life as a ransom for many. Ask the question, when you're dead, how will people remember you? Will they say she or he was a generous person? I hope so. In a strange way, these two widows speak to us today about our world as it faces climate change. Face it, we must, and it will demand much generosity from everyone and sacrifice if we are to survive. You know, for too long we've been thinking about, you know, it's me, since the 1960s. It's not about me, it's about us, and us. It's about one another. We're here to live in cooperation with others, not to be endlessly fighting. Rich and poor have to solve this problem in the light of faith. You know, autumn reminds us that God has given us a beautiful world, and it is our choice to disfigure it or enhance it. The spirit of generosity to others is the main way in which we make this place better for one another. Individuals, family, the church, community, and nation. I'm reminded of the prayer of St. Ignatius. Lord Jesus, teach me to be generous. Teach me to serve as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heal the wounds, to labour and not to seek rest, to give of myself and not to ask reward. Accept the reward of knowing that I am doing your will. Amen.
Stand and reaffirm our faith by saying together the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten of man, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our Saviour's crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. First, pray for the Church of God universal throughout the world, for Francis, the Chief Bishop, Justin, Archbishop Canterbury, and Jonathan, our Bishop. We pray that Christians the world over may show a generosity of spirit in the way in which we live our lives. That we may listen to the word of God and act upon it. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the world which God made, sustained by the Spirit and redeemed by Christ Jesus. Pray that we may all work for peace, that we may cooperate with others and share the beauty and the bounty of the earth. We pray especially for the conference being held in Glasgow, that it may be a positive, that there may be a positive outcome in terms of protecting the world from unreasonable temperature increases. We pray for all the nations of the world, that we may all work for the common good. especially this time we hold up to God the people of the Lebanon and Afghanistan. Pray too for our own country, our head of state, Elizabeth, our Queen, and those who serve under her. Lord, in your mercy. We pray too for the local community here in Burnt Oak, our friends and neighbours, and the church here especially. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Pray for all who are in need, for the lonely, the sick, for those afflicted in body, mind, or spirit. And our prayers are asked for Michael, Bella, Lydia, Annabelle, Tanya, Bill, Mary, Evelyn, Stephen, and Carl. We pray for all known to ourselves who suffer in any way. We pray that they may know Christ's presence in their lives and for his words, do not be afraid. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And of your charity, pray for those who have died, family, friends, loved ones. And of the recently departed, we pray for the soul of Joan Richards and Aidan Mayos, priest. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and may light perpetual shine upon them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Finally, we bring to the Lord our own concerns, our hopes and our fears, our worries, but equally we bring to the Lord our joys and our thanksgivings. And so rejoice in fellowship with all your saints. We commend ourselves to all Christian people to unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I think we nod to one another or whatever we do now. Peace be with you.
Thank you. setting him over the whole world with all its wonder. You made man the steward of creation, to praise you day by day for the marvels of your wisdom and power, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your grace and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Now, conference, we pray.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work with your praise and glory. Amen. The Lord be with you. Bow our heads for God's blessing. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, come down upon you and remain with you, now and always. Amen. Are there any notices? Notices? No? Okay, that's fine, good.
Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death.
And the word was made flesh.
And the word of God is with thee.
Blessed art thou.